As she said, my name is Brian Simpson. I'm coming to you guys from Baylor University Medical Center. It's a great honor and privilege. It's a great honor and privilege to be able to present to you guys one of our transcatheter pulmonic valve replacements within the Ross position. Unfortunately, I have no disclosures to provide you yet. Our patient is a 59-year-old, very pleasant gentleman. He has a complex congenital heart history and an adult history of AFib and hypertension. He had had his first surgery in 1965 as an open aortic valvuloplasty, and then underwent a Ross procedure in 1993. Those procedures were done in another state, and we didn't have the full story or back records of that. In 2011, he was presented to our surgeons and underwent aortic root replacement with a 29.3F aortic valve implantation. At that same time, he underwent mitral and tricuspid ring annuloplasties and a cryomase and left atrial appendage ligation. He then was followed by our teams pretty closely until 2018 when he developed severe aortic stenosis. With a heart team approach and with the patient's preference, the decision was made to proceed with percutaneous intervention for this stenosis, given his three prior open heart surgeries. This top left, you can see the final result of a 26S3 in place of the 3F valve. And going from top right to bottom right, you can see the placement and then deployment of that S3 valve within the 3F valve. He had been doing well through 2018 and was closely followed by our team until 2021, when he developed slowly progressive dyspnea on exertion and a new hemolytic anemia that was unexplained. Imaging did confirm severe pulmonic stenosis, and our CT imaging showed us circumferential calcification and stenosis of the Ross graft with involvement of all of the pulmonic leaflets. Based again on a heart team approach and the patient preference, the decision was made to pursue a transcatheter approach rather than repeat open heart surgery. Our initial imaging did suggest that we could be able to pre-dilate this stenosis and then place a 26S3 with about a 20% oversizing. This imaging was supported by all of the images we had. In any pulmonic valve intervention from a percutaneous approach, the coronary anatomy is incredibly important to understand and to prepare for. With the balloon dilatation and then a stent deployment within the pulmonary artery, you can have compression of the coronary arteries. And in particular in this patient, because of the graft implantation of the coronary arteries, knowing that anatomy is going to be important. We obtained right femoral vein and right left femoral artery access. Here you can see our wire across the pulmonic valve and into the left lower PA. And you can see here the first pulmonary angiogram that we took showing severe PI and a gradient of about 68 across that valve. The severe PI was likely contributed by the catheter and wire that were across the valve. We use biplane for all of our pulmonary artery interventions in order to better visualize the coronary artery anatomy as it relates to the pulmonary artery, and also to well visualize the pulmonic valve itself and where we will be placing the stented valve. You can see here in red, that is the TAVR in SAVR valve in the LAO projection. Our in-procedure imaging also supported our decision to pre-dilate and then try to get a 26S3 in that place. We initiated with an 18 balloon valvuloplasty and then followed that with a 21 balloon valvuloplasty. You can see here full expansion of the 21 millimeter balloon with simultaneous coronary injection showing no compromise of coronary flow. Again, you can see in the middle of the screen the TAVR in SAVR, and at the bottom of the screen you can see the mitral and tricuspid rings. Immediately after the 21 balloon valvuloplasty, we identified a contained perforation within the pulmonary artery, likely contained within the scar tissue around the Ross graft. This is before and after BPV, and you can see that contained perforation there. On that, we decided to place a covered mountain stent. We chose to cover the entirety of the pulmonic valve leaflets in order to ensure that we fully contained this perforation. So with deployment of that covered stent, And then from a caudal projection, we saw good expansion of that stent, or at least reasonable expansion of that stent, with no compromise to coronary flow. From this point on, until we have a valve in, we essentially have no pulmonic valve. So easy flow back and forth across the pulmonary artery, which essentially causes a hypovolemic shock type of picture from the LV perspective. As we had a perforation with a 21 balloon, we elected not to pursue a 24 dilatation and to instead immediately go to an S323. We chose to add 2 cc's to the balloon for that dilatation. We chose our landing zone to try to match where the pulmonic leaflets were in the pre-imaging as well. Unfortunately, during deployment, the S3 migrated in a proximal direction, likely related to that persistent diameter discrepancy between the pulmonary artery with the covered stent and the RVOT. You can see here that deployment. Despite forward pressure on the deployment and negative tension on the wire, we were not able to keep it in that position. Immediately after deployment of this S3, pulmonary artery angiogram did show a severe regurgitation in the paravalvular area immediately superior and anterior to that valve, likely poor apposition between the S3 skirt and the covered stent. This is that biplane view of that same severe PI in a short video. Fortunately, his hemodynamics were improved, which gave us time to plan. We elected to place a second S3, again with plus 2 cc's. This would still be undersized by about 10%. At the transition zone between that first S3 and the covered stent, we knew that our landing zone would be very narrow if we were to capture all three of the leaflets of the first S3 and maintain complete apposition between the covered stent and the first S3 skirt. After deployment there, we actually had excellent apposition there with full capture of the first S3 and only trace paravalvular leak around that site. Echocardiography during and after the case confirmed a nearly complete resolution of the stenosis. A gradient persisted peak of about 9 and minimal to trace PI. The patient ended up being discharged on post-op day 1 and has been seen in follow-up. His symptoms have dramatically improved, his hemoglobin has improved, and he has returned to his normal active lifestyle. And since that time, this week, we actually proceeded with another transcatheter pulmonic valve implantation in a failed Ross successfully this week. Wow. Yeah, thank you for your time, and I welcome any questions.
Fascinating case. We'll open this up. I mean, a failed Ross procedure with multiple attempts. Yeah.
So the covered stent that you used was a CP stent, right?
Yes.
The CP. So what are the valves that you could have used, especially since you had this problem, was would you not think of using a Melody?
So a Melody had been discussed, yes. But I think in the moment, after we'd placed the covered stent, the decision was we don't have enough time to really plan out a Melody placement and obtain.
I see. You didn't have it ready available. Yeah. Okay.
We did. Please. We didn't pre-plan a Melody, which would have been quite useful to have that available.
Because a Melody would be a better valve choice in this situation because you 22 Melody, which would be the right size. And the advantage of Melody, it's a covered stent, and it's longer. So because it's longer and it's covered, you would have managed to do it with just one attempt to go the whole thing.
Well, thank you.
Did you use a, what kind of delivery sheath or system did you use to deliver the sapien?
Oh, shoot. You know, I don't actually remember. I didn't write it down for this case. I'm sorry.
The general teaching is to use a long sheath and cross it and unsheath the valve rather than use the sapien system to flex and go around because of the risk of damaging either the tricuspid valve or having trouble making the turn in the RV outflow tract to get up to the valve. So we try to usually use a long dry seal, like an 18 French dry seal, and then just unsheath the valve, advance that over the stiff wire into the proximal pulmonary artery.
And that's actually an excellent point. That was what we had done with both of the valves. We used a dry seal.
Use a long dry seal.
Long dry seal, yep.
Thank
and then unsheathed each one. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.